Haven't heard this one in a long time.
What's that?
I haven't, tell me the story of Jesus. I haven't heard it in a long time.
Oh, let's see. It's in the
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Sorry. I'm watching. For Jesus, your King, there's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. You've been to Jesus for the cleansing part. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Works together.
Trembles at His voice, trembles.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
And we're glad that you all could make it. We know a number of people who haven't been able to. And we pray for them this morning that they'll be safe. Glad to see Diane is here with her new knee. It must be industrial strength to get through the ice and the snow. So that's great. And I know Ed's truck was frozen, so thank you to Andy. So we're glad to be here to worship. We pray as we sing and proclaim God's word that will draw others in to proclaim our God. This morning we're going to continue while following our Lord on the Jericho Road. This morning, of course, Palm Sunday, we'll be celebrating his ride into Jerusalem, in which he proclaims himself to be the king. And so our call to worship is one of the Old Testament psalms, part of the Old Testament psalm, that was sung perhaps when the ark was being brought into Jerusalem. You go into Jerusalem, into the doors, lifting up your heads is more of a metaphorical way of saying, stand up, lift yourselves up. This is a day of joy because the King of Glory is coming in. So let me read this for you. It's from Psalm 24, verses 7 through 10. Lift up your heads, O gates, be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of Glory may come in. Who is this King of Glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, and lift them up, O ancient doors, that the King of Glory may come in. Who is the King of Glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of Glory. Let's bow our heads. Father, we're very grateful this morning that we have opportunity to worship you, to remember what Jesus did on our behalf, to remember his love, his compassion, his determination, Lord, to provide a way for us to come with him as the King of Glory in through the gates of heaven. And we pray this morning that you bless our singing, our preaching, that it would be led of your Spirit, that you'll prepare our hearts and all hearts that might hear the message or sing along with us to receive him, to lift up the heads of their hearts, to receive the King of Glory this morning into their hearts, and to honor him by serving and loving him all the days of their lives. We thank you, Father. Bless this time, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And please stand and we'll sing about the blood that makes it possible for all of us to go through those gates of glory. Number 337, Nothing But the Blood.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other font I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon, this I see. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing, this my plea. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the
not of good at all.
please be seated as Carl leads us in prayer.
Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome. It's wonderful to have the sun out after that day we had yesterday. We got a few things to highlight here on our prayer request. Well, first of all is Diane's here. I just can witness that she's doing great with her new knee operation. Make sure to keep Tom and Diane in prayer because they're going through a tough time. And I'm sure you're reminded of that during the week, you know, as things come across your thoughts. Praise on Carrie Ann's mom. She's doing good, right? Yep. This week we're going to be praying for Sycamore Drive in Williamstown. I can't say that I know exactly where that is, even though I've lived here all my life. But let's pray that all the people on that street will come to know the Lord and start coming to church. The other highlights I got is, you know, pray for this summer when the other churches come to do ministries here, that, you know, their hearts grow with God and also ours, and may good things come of all that. We're going to have a special meeting after church today to receive new members, and we're having a ham dinner also, so stick around for that. I guess Chuck is doing Maundy Thursday service, probably going to do the Lord's table. So I guess we can talk to him if you have questions about that. Is there any other prayer requests? Helen? Helen's granddaughter has got colon cancer. Jessica, you said her name was? Jessica, you said her name was? Okay, Jessica Darling. Helen? That's your daughter? Okay, Helen's daughter fell, pulled something. She's got to go to the doctor tomorrow, so pray that it's nothing too serious. Oh. So we're going to have to keep Barb's sister in prayer. Her cancer has come back. Doesn't know exactly what the prognosis is on all of it, but we'll pray. Then we've been having pretty good luck with our prayers lately, so let's all pray for that. And hopefully she'll be coming out of this easily. Okay, I guess that's it. Let's go to the Lord. Lord, you've heard the prayers that we've asked today. I'm sure there's many others on this list that I'm sure people review during the week and stuff, especially keep our friend Tom and Diane, comfort them in this time. Also, Barb's family, they've had a tough time in the last few weeks, and now her sister's got cancer again, so keep a hand on all of them. And I pray that all of us here are good Christians. Oh, also, we are going to have to pray for Mike Carroll, Pownell, Vermont, Pownell, North Pownell Church. So let's pray for him, that his ministry continues and does well, as well as ours. I guess that's it. We're going to pray that all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Please stand and we'll praise our Lord.
Sin, there's power in There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for our cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. And for the cleansing power, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in his grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? When the bridegroom cometh, will your robes be white? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for the mansions bright and be washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Amen. the story of Jesus. Please be seated, and please, in the pew Bibles, you can turn to page 878. We'll be looking again at the Gospel of Luke, chapter 19, verses 28 through 40. Again, Luke 19, 28 through 40, page 878, or in your own Bibles. We'll look at Jesus coming into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. And of course, this is a very familiar story. And sometimes with familiarity, it becomes difficult to appreciate all that's going on, much like relationships. When you've been together for a long time, sometimes we can take for granted many of the things that are most important. And so we want to talk about that this morning. Let me read verses 28 through 40. As I say, they're very familiar. And then we'll pray and ask God to bless us this morning. And when he had said these things, he, Jesus, went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he drew near to Bethphage and to Bethany, at the mount that is called Olivet, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village in front of you, where on entering you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever yet sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' you shall say this, 'The Lord has need of it.' And so those who were sent away and found it just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owner said to them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' And they said, 'The Lord has need of it.' And they brought it to Jesus, and throwing their cloaks on the colt, they sat Jesus on it. And as he rode along, they spread their cloaks on the road. And as he was drawing near, already on the way down the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest.' And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' And he answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out.'" Let's bow our heads. Father, as always, please take these verses that you penned so long ago through your servant Luke, and by your Spirit, apply them to each of our hearts. You know our individual need, whether for salvation, sanctification, whether for criticism, Lord, critique, challenge, whatever it might be. We know that you've called us here this morning, that all things in this world happen according to your appointment and your direction, and that you have us here to hear your word proclaimed. And we pray that by your Spirit, that word indeed would be powerfully proclaimed. And we claim, Lord, your promise that says that your word, when preached, will not return void, but will accomplish all that you have sent it to do. And Lord, we pray that you fulfill that promise this morning in each of our hearts. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Sometimes hard to remember that in our lives, the Lord is reaching out to us and wants a relationship with each one of us. And that everything that he is doing and he has done in history is in order to have that relationship, not with his bride as a whole particularly, but with each member of the church, of that bride, with you and me, if we know him as Lord. Jesus Christ wants to have a relationship with you. And so he came as a person into this world. We know him because we can see what he did. We have an historical record of what he did, an authentic record, a verified record of what he did, what he said, and what it meant to each of us. Because then after the Gospels, we have the Gospel, the epistles written by Paul and Peter and John, applying what Jesus had said and done, showing us what it meant to each one of us. But here in the Gospels, we have so much because we have the history of Jesus, and it's in our individual histories that people know each one of us. Jesus, during these last weeks, as we've shown him, has been moving towards Jerusalem. And he said now three times to the disciples on the way that I'm going up to Jerusalem and I will be crucified there and rise the third day. He's been saying that. And yet at the same time, knowing that he was headed for this, along the way his compassion was overflowing on the blind man, on the tax collector, on you and me, because as we hear those stories again, as we hear the gospel again, he is working again in our hearts and lives to try to remind us of his love for us. Despite the fact that he's doing so much for our eternal salvation, he's also interested in our daily lives, in what happens with each one of us. And it's in demonstrating that that his words are validated. In any relationship, as we talked this morning in Sunday school, the superficial is easy. And frequently we get caught up with the superficial. You know, certainly when I was younger, if somebody was good looking, if they had a good sense of humor, if they liked to dance, if they liked to do all these things, I was drawn to that. And I didn't really pay too much attention to the more substantial things that we say in a wedding ceremony, in sickness and in health, good times and bad times, till death do you part. Those things which make a long-standing, a true relationship. How do I know that when the chips are down, the person will stand by me? Well, one of the ways that we know is by what they say, is by whether they tell us the truth. You know, it's so important in any relationship to be honest, to be truthful. You know, and that's hard. I don't know about you guys, but especially for a guy, you know, when your wife says to me, you know, do these the outfit make me look fat? And you see, I see a couple of people, their head, guys, their heads are down like this, and the women are laughing. Hey, well, that's a comical example. But what about more serious things, hon? Did you think I handled that rightly with my son or daughter? Do you think what I said to my boss was a good thing or a bad thing? I have this issue at work. Is it my responsibility to say something? To say truth and love? Or do I just cover it up? We all know how to cover it up. You know, with a quick smile or a laugh and change the topic. But see, Jesus is truthful. He's truthful about good and bad. And because he's truthful about bad, we can trust him when he says something good. Says here at the beginning of the verse, when he had said these things. You know, and it's one of those clauses that you could just kind of jump over because you know you're going to Palm Sunday. But what were these things? Oh, what we just read about the blind man and the tax collector? Well, no, not in this passage. What had happened in this passage is after he had called Zacchaeus, the tax collector, down from the tree. After he said, today salvation has come to this house, since he is also a son of Abraham, for the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. There's this parable inserted called the parable of the 10 minas. And Jesus made a surprising statement. You know, because when we're trying to encourage people to follow us, a lot of times we don't want to say something difficult. And that's hard for pastors, for anybody. I would like to see the church filled. I know what to say in order to fill a church. I can say what people want to hear. And as we talked this morning, you can't do that because as a pastor, you're called to preach the word. Preach the word. You're basically called to tell the truth. And so Jesus, because he knew in their minds, they were thinking, as we'll see, that he was going to come and inaugurate the kingdom wanted to make sure they understood the truth that this would not happen immediately. There would be difficult times, not only for him, but for them. And they would be called to give an account for their lives. But not having him as reigning king immediately. So verse 11, as they heard these things about the tax collector, about the blind beggar, as they heard these things, he proceeded to tell a parable. Because he was near to Jerusalem, and because they supposed that the kingdom of God was going to appear immediately. It ought to be a caution to you and me. In our world, especially as things fly out of control, we spend more time talking about the rapture than we do how we can love our brother. You know, because we might not be here when the rapture comes. We might be gone tomorrow. So our greater concern ought to be with the more certain, and that is that we ought to love our brother while we're here. And if Jesus happens to come and take us, praise the Lord. But if I know Christ, whenever I die, I'm going to see Jesus. And I'm going to be enraptured. They supposed the kingdom of God was to appear immediately. He said, therefore, and he goes into a long parable. He talks about a nobleman who goes into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and then return. In the parable, he is that nobleman. What he's telling them is he's going to leave and he's going to come back. A far country, so it won't be soon. So he will leave and come back at some point in the future. But while he's gone, he calls together his servants and gives them 10 minas and says, engage in business until I come. In the context of Scripture, love your neighbor until I come. Take what God has given and use it to glorify me and glorify the kingdom. But when he did that, what happened? Verse 14, his citizens hated him and sent a delegation after him saying, we do not want this man to reign over us. In line with everything he had been saying about what was about to happen in Jerusalem, he was going to be rejected. A little bit earlier in chapter 18, taking the 12 aside, he said, see, we are going up to Jerusalem. Everything that is written about the Son of Man by the prophets will be accomplished. He will be delivered to the Gentiles, be mocked, shamefully treated, spit upon, flogged. They will kill him, and on the third day, he will rise. Third time he had said this, and yet, as that saying, that verse concludes, they understood none of these things. Why? Because it wasn't within their frame of expectation. They had a certain expectation of what was going to happen when the Messiah came, and this wasn't it. And so we don't want this man to reign over us. The story goes on, the parable about the 10 minas being given. People engage in business. Some people earn more. Some people don't earn anything. But the whole point of the message is at the end. You will be judged by what you do with what you have. You're not a preacher, not standing up here. It doesn't matter to God. We are all the same in God's eyes. God expects each one of us, wherever we are, to serve him and do the best we can with what he's given us. And for people we know now and love, sometimes at the end of our lives, that's at the Williamstown Commons or in a hospital bed, in sickness and illness, and that's where you want somebody to be with you till death do you part. We need to preach Christ wherever he puts us. That's our mission field. That's our mission field. And if we will not, the end of the parable says, but as for these enemies of mine who did not want me to reign over them, bring them here and slaughter them before me. Would you say that if you were trying to accumulate a following? If you were trying to encourage a girl to go out with you, say, listen, if you don't go out with me, if you don't marry me, your life is going to be a mess. It's
say, well, you're pretty full of yourself, fella. But see, what we hear here is the truth that he had been saying from the beginning. And the reason they would suffer is because they will not accept that he suffered for them. He was saying he's going up to be mocked, spit upon, flogged, and crucified, nailed to a cross. He is going to take this in my place. And if I will not accept it, I, at the end of my life, will be lost. As we saw last week, the word lost had to do with destruction. I will lose my life in the most painful way. And so Jesus tells the parable and he tells the truth. He tells the truth to each one of us. And then, in order to verify that he's telling the truth, give us one more example of the fact that he knows what will happen, he gives us this illustration using the donkey. Go into the village in front of you. You will find a colt tied on which no one has ever yet sat. Untie it, bring it here. If anyone asks, why are you untying it? The Lord has need of it. Say to those who were sent, so those who were sent went away, found it just as he told them. See, everything in this passage is just as he tells us. When you marry somebody, you want that person to be honest to a fault. You want them to tell you, yes, that pair of jeans, that dress makes you look heavy. You want that. That honesty with love, because you'd rather hear it from somebody who loves you than somebody laughing at you as you're walking down the street. You want the person to be honest. Jesus is willing and able to tell us everything because he knows what will happen. He knows there will be a colt there. He knows he will be able to ride that colt. I'm not a farmer. I don't deal with animals, but I understand that to sit on any animal that's never been ridden before is to take your life in your hands because the animal doesn't like it and tries to throw you off. And yet here Jesus is not only telling them, I'm in control of what happens, I am in control of every aspect, even this young colt. I will ride on this colt, and the colt will enable me. Just as I was able to tell the winds to calm, just as I was able to feed the 5,000, to walk on water, everything in this world is under my control. And so when I tell you that if you don't follow me, you will suffer destruction, that is also the truth. That is also the truth. And so Jesus, in the parable of the 10 minas and in the prediction of his crucifixion, has laid the groundwork for what he will do now. Because he wants us to know that those things, yes, they're true, but this greater truth is also true. Because when he rides down Mount Olivet, the Mount of Olives, into Jerusalem, he is, at that moment, proclaiming himself to be king. Because he was aware of the expectation in the Jewish community. David, when he was putting Solomon on his throne, said, take Solomon, put him on my donkey, and lead him in and anoint him as king. Zechariah says, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you, righteous, and having salvation is he, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. The Lord of all things was fulfilling purposely this scripture, and he was proclaiming to everyone in that place. And there were, and by some accounts, between 1 million and 2 million people for the Passover in Jerusalem. As he was coming down the Mount of Olivet, and if he was coming down on that day, they were singing the psalm. that included this phrase, Psalm 118, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven, glory in the highest." They were acknowledging that He was King. Jesus Christ is King. Not just of heaven, but of everything. You say, well, people don't acknowledge Him. Well, when I was in Cheshire growing up, I couldn't have told you who the president was for the first 10 years, but he was still the president, whether I knew him or believed it or not. And for people in this world, Jesus Christ is King. And it doesn't matter if you live someplace and you don't know that. It doesn't change the reality, doesn't change the fact. And Jesus, by telling us the worse and the more painful truths, is verifying the accuracy of this truth: I am the King. And of course, when He said that, well, people had wrong expectations. The disciples, of course, they heard it, and they began proclaiming Him to be King. Proclaiming Him because they expected, just as we've just been told, that when the King, when the Messiah came, the Romans would be thrown out. And that Israel would once again prosper and be mighty as it was in the days of David. They were expecting a political king. Somebody that would help them with their problems, with their finances, with their jobs, with all those things on the outside. But what Jesus wanted to do was ride in and be King, not only of them politically, but personally of your heart. He wanted you to open up the gates of your heart on that day and say what the psalm says: be lifted up, be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory might come in. You have to make a choice in your life which king you will serve. And generally for people nowadays, that is yourself or Jesus. You will decide for yourself what is good. You will decide who you will marry, what job you will take, where you will live, what you will eat, how you will raise your family if you have kids, what you will tell them, what you won't tell them. You will decide, or you will listen to Jesus and let Him guide your life. He will be your King. He will be your King. And so the disciples had a wrong expectation, and so did the Pharisees. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Him, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." Why? Because their expectation wasn't being met either. In the beginning of John, they were asking John the Baptist, "Are you Elijah? Are you that prophet?" We read about that prophet this morning. Moses said, "There'll be a prophet like me who comes. Listen to him. Are you John the Baptist?" Malachi had said that John the Baptist would be coming back. "Are you Elijah?" Elijah had gone to heaven in a chariot of fire. Their expectation was for a political king, but not for that king to say, "Abraham, before Abraham was, I am." They were not prepared for the Messiah to be the Son of God, to say, "I and the Father are one." See, their expectations were wrong. And rather than change their expectations, they do what you and I do. You know, we get in a relationship with the wrong person, we see all the superficial stuff, and then we put on them all of our expectations. They're going to be kind, they're going to be gentle, they're going to put me first, they're always going to provide, all of these things. They're going to be honest. We put all those, we just assume them, we just put them there, and then we make excuses every time they're not one of those things. Until pretty soon, we have this pile of excuses, and then what do? We turn our back. We don't want to know it. We want our expectations. And we don't adjust to the reality and to the truth. And Jesus says, no. Adjust your expectations. I am not here as a political messiah. I have told you three times I'm coming to be crucified for your sin. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. I have told you I'm going to be crucified. And to the Pharisees, adjust your expectations. I am the Son of God. And if you would read your own scripture, you would see, just as he told them when he said that he was going up to Jerusalem, he said, everything written by the prophets in your scriptures, Pharisees, everything there will be accomplished. Everything there will be accomplished. And so Jesus has told us the truth. And that truth gives him credibility when he talks to us and says he loves us and he'll never leave us. And he's spoken to people with wrong expectations. And, you know, the question obviously is, what are your expectations for a Savior, for a God, for Jesus? You know? Do you want him to come into your heart and take control of your life? Or do you want him to kind of live next door and help you in crises? Or maybe just have a mother-in-law's apartment, you know, over there. You know, mom's downstairs in the Airbnb. But we're not going to listen to her until we have something we have a problem with. See, what's your expectation for Jesus? Are you willing to give him control? Make him the King of Glory? Recognize he's the Son of God? Are you willing to adjust your expectations? And so, in adjusting them, I guess one way to know whether you will you sing when others are silent? I love this. I'll tell you, if these were silent, the rocks would cry out. Ever since I heard a song by the Cathedrals 30 years ago, you know, the rocks shall not cry out in my place. As long as I have breath to live, my voice shall give him praise. Will the rocks cry out in your place when Jesus returns? Are you waiting with such anticipation that you would burst into song if you saw him coming? You know, Elena, we talked over the last weeks. I've forgotten how we got on the subject, but when she grew up in Ecuador, you know, boyfriends would come to their balcony and they would sing songs of love. You know, and we had our wedding song, Rick Astley, Never Gonna Give You Up, Never Gonna Give You Up, Never Gonna Make You Cry, Never Gonna Say Goodbye and Desert You. You burst into song. When you see something or somebody that you love, you want to sing, you want to pick up your children in your arms. So what do? Especially when they're moving, we start singing. We start singing. I used to know some songs by Jay and the Temptations that were nice and quiet songs. You start singing, they fall asleep. Hopefully before I did. You know, we burst into song because we want to express our joy, and we have no other way to do it adequately because it's within us. It's not something that's exterior or superficial. It's because something has touched us inside, our hearts lifted us up. The joy has lifted us up. That's why it's so amazing. You know, when we read in the book of Zechariah that God, Zephaniah, that God will stand over us and he will sing. The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exalt over you with loud singing. The Lord Jesus Christ standing at your balcony, serenading you because he loves you. That's what it's saying. Hard to imagine, isn't it? That Jesus loves you that much. You know why you can trust him? Because he told you the hard things before he told you the good things. He is telling you the truth, always and ever. And so my only challenge to me and to you is to never let the rocks cry out. Never let the rocks cry out. How do you do that? You maintain your relationship. How do I do it with Elena? We talk. Sometimes one of us talks, sometimes the other one talks. We have a relationship. We share the road. We share life. You need to share a relationship with Christ, because if you do, that honesty and that love that He will demonstrate to you by His preaching and teaching to you in His Word will just so overwhelm you that you'll burst into song and you'll never let the rocks cry out. Let's bow our heads. Father, thank you for this opportunity to remember your love, to remember what you were saying that day when you rode into Jerusalem, that you were expressing your love for us in the middle of doing that, something you would do the following week. You told us, or we were told in Scripture, that greater love has no man than this, than that he give up his life for his fellow. And you gave up your life for me, Lord. What more can I say, Lord? What more can I say but I love you? In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Please stand and join us. And we'll sing "How Great Is Our God." We'll try.
How great
is our God.
For all that you do for us, and we pray, Lord, that your grace would enable us to speak to others truthfully, but in love, that we would go through them with good times and bad as you do with us, that we might love them as you have loved us, and that in doing that, they will be drawn to the God of love. They will be drawn to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And have a good week. And we're going to ask everyone here to be seated for a moment. And we'll have a special meeting. But we will ask the Lord's blessing on those who must leave us. We don't have Melanie. No. Okay. Well, Melanie and Dave are snowed in, so Melanie's not here. We know Tom and Diane. We know that situation. Might have to call some people back. Do we have 10? Raise your hands if you're a member. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Praise the Lord. Okay.